Buenos días y bienvenidos hasta.
Good morning and welcome to this third session of the joint initiative between Real Instituto Elcano and Naturgy Foundation about the geopolitical trends of the energy transition, which is a forum for debate for energy transition, looking to different places in the world. We started the first year with the Middle East, and last year, after the U.S. passed the IRA, we looked to the West, and now we're looking to the Eastern Mediterranean. So during this debate, which is in a hybrid method with people here and also some people remotely, we have with us Jose Juan Diaz, who is the president of Real Instituto Elcano, and Rafael, who is the president of the Naturgy Foundation. Thank you very much to you all for coming here and for being remotely connected with us. I would like to tell you about the goals of the Naturgy Foundation. Our objectives, our budgets, look to two things, social activities that you probably are aware of that we are very proud of because we devote half of our budget and our activities to this end. And the second, where today's event fit, goes to promoting and developing activities that will propose notes, events, seminaries, or conferences to give well-founded opinions and information on the energy industry. We believe that this very complicated industry requires light to be shed on it so that the best decisions can be made in this ever-changing energy world, especially when we have to face a great challenge of energy transition. We also devote half of our effort and our money, and one of these subjects becomes very specific in geostrategic topics. Historically, it has been so. Geostrategy is linked to energy for many years, and it is no doubt that the energy transition, and due to the critical political crisis, it is more important than ever. When we thought about dealing with this subject, we thought of looking to expert entities that are well known in the world and that would cooperate with us. So I want to thank Real Instituto Elcano and its president here, that they were very interested and cooperated with us already in this third session to organize this seminar that could shed some light and interest on geostrategy and energy. To speak about geostrategy and energy is today a very trending topic. It is present in political realms and economic realms, and it cannot be otherwise. It is a key situation, and doubtlessly, the energy transition will alter the balances and situations because its origin and its distribution is going to have different parameters, and there is no doubt that for many years we will still be having to keep in mind what are the current situations by which the energy reaches our markets, mainly from hydrocarbon sources, and in that area that we're going to look to today. So to keep that in mind, to know the conditioning elements, is going to be very important because it has caused in the past and may in the future cause punctual crises that have touched political business sectors. So that is why it is a great satisfaction to be able to introduce to you this event that tries to go deep down into what happens in the Eastern Mediterranean, what can we expect from it, and what are the main challenges that we have to tackle here and now with this very complicated situation within the very complicated energy world. That is why I want to thank again those who will be participating today, the speakers, and of course to Gonzalo, who will be moderating. I want to thank again the president of Real Instituto Elcano for his support to be able to jointly organize this meeting. Without further ado, I'm going to give the floor to José Juan. Thank you very much, Rafael. It is a great pleasure and honor to be here today. Naturgy is one of the essential sponsors of Real Instituto Elcano, and these patrons not only provide the money to support us, but they also provide the questions. And in a world of uncertainties, in a world of great changes, to find the right answers is the first step to be able to accomplish a good research. So we're very satisfied for having had them incentivating us, talking to our teams to be able to organize this event. And thank you to you all, those who are here and those who are behind the screens. To Elcano team, Gonzalo, Lara, Ignacio, who have made this event possible. I believe this is the second or third year that we organize this event. I believe that one of the subjects that to frame somewhat this panel today, one of the topics that I would like to frame here, is that even if there is a hyperbolic world where everything is new, it is a new order and a new challenge for our living together, probably energy will still be one of the great future challenges for humanity, for mankind, and it is one of the elements that will condition what is and how will we be in the coming 20, 50, 100 years. And in my opinion, this has to do with the interaction of three large axes. On the one hand, we have the fight against climate change, which is anthropogenic, we know, and we have to find to fight against it. The second important axis, in my opinion, is that we have a new energy situation, an energy situation where we have new sources of energy, some will grow, others won't, that are competing against each other and which are fed by a technology which is being developed very quickly, not only in terms of generation, but also in mitigating the emission impact on the climate change goal. And the third circumstance that somehow might be overlooked, but which will have a great impact for our future, is that in this new energy order that will appear, or that we will be building, the state intervention degree will be much greater than the one we saw in the past. So these threefold factors will define a set of factions, urgency in time, and will condition how we will be tackling it. There is a third leg or a second research analysis, which is that, in my opinion, this new world order doesn't appear from vacuum. There has been already a new order, and the diplomacy of the old energy and the diplomacy of the new energy will interact and will create conflict situations, but also maybe also cooperation situations. We shouldn't be too pessimistic. So I believe that from that interaction between the old and the new is something that we have to keep a close eye on, because if history can be used as a precedent, the old diplomacy of the oil, to call it somehow, has the resources, has the capacity, has a basic resource, which is energy, and will interact with the new diplomacies. So I believe this is something that we should keep in mind and analyze on a regular basis. The second topic is that Spain's position in each of the problems is different, but we have something that conditions us, which is geography. And energy geography is global, but it is also local and regional. And we are immersed in a situation not only with the states, but also with the European Union that is acting in each of the three axes that I mentioned. And we are in an energy geography which is especially complicated. Especially complicated, I underline. And this gives back this trilogy that we have been thinking for decades about the need to have clean energies, competitive energy prices, and supply guarantee. There are too many triangles in this equation to be able to sum it up in a first approximation. This is what we expect our speakers will do. And we are sure they will. But if we want to look to where are the geostrategic aspects, and they have to introduce the geography, they have to introduce the goal of supply, sustainable energies, and supply energy guarantee. And they will have to introduce in this map the old diplomacy, the new diplomacy, and the new triangle that would be between emission reduction, on the other hand, the important topic of the increase of state intervention, the regulation aspect, which is going to be very important, and the interaction, the urgency. Time is ticking. I'm not especially pessimistic about transition. I think we're learning a lot along the way. Maybe we should have learned more before, but my perception is that we can join together, even if it might seem difficult, the different forces that we have in place, because some compensate others. Not everything is bad all the time, in the same way as not everything is good all the time, and some of the problems generated by these frictions will give opportunities for capable, efficient companies with the right vision and technology will be able to help us resolve this problem that, as in any time in history, to have the energy we need is key for the growth, stability, and peace. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, José Juan Ruiz. I apologize because before I made a mistake with the last name, and Rafael Villaseca. I hope we will have a very interesting and exciting debate so that we can understand much better what is happening in the area, especially from the energy perspective. As it was said before, it might be an area that can become a link between Europe and the East, not only with regards to fuel oils, but also with renewable energies. To start with the session, we have with us Ana Palacio. To introduce Ana Palacio is very difficult. It's almost impossible considering her professional background. She has been in different public administrative positions, out of which I would underline having been Minister of Foreign Affairs in Spain, Vice President of the World Bank. And she mainly works in the energy industry, and she is a board member of different companies. She's the founding of the law firm Palacio and Asociados. She has a great knowledge of geopolitics and geostrategy, and she is very aware, especially of the energy sector. So it is a great privilege to have Ana here. Thank you very much for having accepted the invitation from Real Instituto Elcano and Naturgy Foundation. So we're going to have a conversation with her. We're going to have a dialogue with Ana Palacio. We have Gonzalo Escribano, who's director of the Energy and Climate Program of Real Instituto Elcano, who's an expert in the subject. So it is a great honor to have you here with us, Gonzalo. So without further ado, you have the floor. Thank you very much, Manuel, and the Naturgy Foundation, and its great team for allowing us to be here today. And thank you, Ana, for giving some room in your very busy agenda. It is a great honor for us and for me to have the opportunity of talking to you, having this dialogue. It is a great privilege to do it with the first foreign affairs minister that we had here in Spain, so it is very valuable. I'm not going to waste any more time talking about your CV, which is so large. But dear Ana, as we were saying the other day, unfortunately, we are in a passionate geopolitical moment. It has been very well introduced in the opening remarks, so I'm not going to speak anymore about Ukraine, Russia, our rivalry with China, which is growing, and it is extending to the decarbonized chains, and as always, something that is always present, the Middle East, and in our case, the Eastern Mediterranean. And we know very well what is happening right now in the region, in the different countries, and jointly in all the region. But what I would ask you, considering this geopolitical context and the fact that many democracies, the US, the European Parliament, India, and others, we not only have to look to a navel, I would like to start by asking you, how do you see the geopolitical landscape, globally speaking? What do you think will be the main vectors that will foster its evolution? And where do you think this evolution is taking us to? These are very simple questions that you will be able to sum up, and especially that we have to do it in a very short period of time, even though time is as scarce good. I would like to start thanking you for having invited me. It is a great honor to be here, and it is a great pride to see that many international companies like Naturgy, whose trend shows that companies are understanding what are the challenges and goals. And of course, Real Instituto Elcano with Gonzalo, some days ago, we were talking about the reflections of the European Union and the larger think tanks that are helping the EU to think about what will be the next mandate, the next commission, what will be the policies in this time of the Green Deal, as we could call second part. 2.0 or 2.0. And we were talking about that, and we have to look at it from a perspective. And in line with what Jose Juan Ruiz and Mr. Villaseca said, there are certain milestones that we have to keep in mind to understand the geostrategy right now. The Ukraine invasion, the Ukraine war, that it showed how precarious the situation was, and it made the European be aware of this insecurity that we are facing, that the European construction has been done on the so-called peace dividends and from the idea that peace was a starting point, milestones to point some of them. The entry of China in the trade, in the World Trade Organization, this is one of the main milestones. And right now, we are greatly dependent from China, and there is a great dependency of international relationships through China, and that is why this milestone, why am I calling it a milestone? Because the optimistic perspective that I have I understand that we have to negotiate with China its new participation in the access to the value chain and the supply chains, where China has been very successful at working with them, but which is threatening the EU because we are greatly dependent from them. We are getting out of the Russian gas, and in certain questions we are 100% dependent of essential components for wind energy and solar energy. And talking about the Middle East, we could not leave aside Iraq. I was looking to the Spanish position, and the Spanish position was to be close to a fundamental ally in a situation of need at a time where what is being debated in the world is whether Europe will be counterpower, counterweight of the United States in a world where some people don't see the threat of Russia. Our new member states, those that are joining in 2004, who joined in 2004, they've seen it. And why? Because in a world where perception is even more important than reality, it has created a perception that goes beyond the US, that goes to the West. And the other very important milestones, economic crisis, where the model that has been understood that development has to go hand in hand with the Western world, and these leads eventually to a democracy, is totally broken. And now here I quote the opening of the Peking Olympic Games, where we saw the explosion of an alternative model. Who presented it? Xi Jinping was the one who took the Olympic Games. And the third point, 2013, Xi Jinping, the Silk Road. These are the data that we must have in mind when we see the current geopolitical situation. And our current geopolitical situation has, as we all know, Jose Juan has said it, and Mr. Villaseca has also said it, we have the idea that there is a rivalry between China and the US, a China which is playing. By the way, if we speak about the Middle East, it is playing positively because it was China who armed the reconciliation between Iran and Saudi Arabia, which is highly commendable. But we are not really seeing what will China's position be in its 2005 Deputy Secretary of State, where they told them, you have to take already up the responsibility of a great power, 2005. And we are there focusing on the Middle East, of course, and of course we have Gaza behind. But we also have everything that is happening there regarding Turkey. We have to speak about Turkey. We have to speak about dependencies. That is the panorama that, in my perspective, is fundamental beyond the Ukraine war for us, Europeans, for us, Westerners. We live in a world where we have this feeling of insecurity, something which is not seen in the same way elsewhere. And I'm going to say something else. Obviously, energy transition is like the northern light. But there is a big world, China, Pakistan, Africa is part of that world, where societies are growing exponentially or are growing greatly in terms of population, and obviously they need energy. So access to energy in many parts of Africa, we have 800 million Africans who don't have electricity to start with. And in general terms, we have to understand that energy transition, of course, we must understand that there are situations. Pakistan was a good example when they said, look, I need carbon, lignite. I need coal. And we have to be realistic in our message to the world. I believe that from the energy perspective, we can start from here. What do you think? I believe this is a good starting point. I think we could take a second step to go to Europe. You have just published a very interesting article that you titled The Uncomfortable Energy Perspectives. Well, I said perspectives. I don't want to be negative. The EU is the product, a more finished product of the world order, which is now being questioned. Russia is certainly the disruptor, and the one lagging behind is China. And the Global South, as it is called, I'm not going to say that it is against, but it wants to have a participation that it didn't have before. With all these weaving, we have to understand, we Europeans, that we have a framework which is the treaty, and the treaty has a complicated situation in the energy world, the energy mix. Energy safety depends on the member states, the fight against the climate change, sustainability, environment depends only on the European Commission. And this imbalance that happens in so many situations was tried to be mediated by the Green Deal, with a basis that was understandable back in 2019. Anyway, the energy safety is there for Europe. We have a greater energy autonomy through the renewable energies. And as Jose Juan Ruiz said, there is going back to the state, something that we are seeing in different realms, and I'm not going to speak about it here because it is present. But from Europe, it goes through the regulation, and it is done through the environment and the Green Deal. What happens with the Green Deal? It is true that when the basis on which it was built fails, the basis was that there was energy safety, then we were in a situation of totally lack of equilibrium. And the greatest success of the Green Deal was to be the framework to be able to react very quickly at a time when the gas dependency plummeted, especially in Germany, but also in Europe, the dependency on the Russian gas. And the Green Deal was like the backbone. It was not part of the goal of the Green Deal, but the Green Deal had started to make the Europeans speak amongst together to look to common solutions for the climate change and sustainability that were linked to the mix, to the energy mix. Some that could be criticized, like the initial exclusion of the nuclear energy from the Brussels taxonomy that made them have to pivot later and put it through the back door. But even to discuss it was good that at the time each member state was rather autonomous in the energy mix.
And therefore, we have a framework which is set, actually, as we said yesterday, something where you need to be lucky, as Napoleon said about his generals. Well, yes, we in Europe were lucky. We had different circumstances. We started with a soft winter, and that was good. And finally, the Green Deal had a very, very negative effect. Europe had not renewed the contracts in many cases in the long term for the supply, specifically the supply of energy. And after all, In 2020 or 2021, I visited a certain country which was a producer, and Ursula von der Leyen visited it, and I was told, yes, we discussed about the interest Europe has about importing our gas, and then we started to say, contracts, 5 years contracts. Because the fact that the gas markets are beginning to be destabilized before the total invasion of Russia on Ukraine is due to the fact that really there's been no investment. Long-term contracts have not continued, and there's a problem of upstream investments. And that's absolutely necessary. When we see nowadays that Total yesterday is negotiating with Oman, a plant with 1 billion of investment, where yes, actually, the energy for that site is going to be solar energy, but it is designed to export LNG to France. France has different problems with their present nuclear fleet. And we need capacities, engineers, capabilities, welders, and so on in Europe. We need that, and we need to improvise and to bring them. And Leta, in a study recently, said we do have a problem. We do not have a domestic market in three very essential aspects, and he's totally right, which are fundamental. Where for the time being, and I'm paraphrasing, but I think that's a precise quote, they've been considered too strategic by the member states, which are, number one, finances, digitalization, telco, but especially, above all, energy. In Spain, with the Pyrenees, we know about that, don't we? We do need to create that European backbone that we've created with the transport networks, but not with the energy grids. And finally, for the future, this present debate we have about the hydrogen grids. Well, hydrogen grids, I understand, are considered as something difficult nowadays. But when we started to talk about solar energy, lots of people only saw difficulties. And now the solar energy is easily produced and cheaply produced by the market. But to me, strategically, clearly, that is the first energy network which is born as a European network. And we need to consider that. We're facing difficult times, economically speaking, but that's it. Anna, I know you've recently been in the region that we're discussing. You mentioned Turkey earlier. Maybe you want to talk about that? You want to share with us some insights? Well, you know, I'm going to start by telling you something which I believe is something that we need to say. COP in Dubai was a great success. There were pre-COP meetings together at the same time that the General Assembly of the United Nations in the previous September. And I remember that one of the persons was extremely angry telling the Secretary General, don't you realize that you are making the fox take care of the hens? The fox would be the oil companies, and the hens would be renewable energy companies. Well, that's not really the case. I believe that this COP has brought common sense and realism. Energy transition, in our case, which is really an energy transition, is going to be made. The concern about clean energy exists, actually, in countries such as China, where they're building coal plants, or India. Rakesh, the minister, told me, Ms. Palacio, I'm going to burn what I have. Lignite, I will burn it, because I share with you, the monsoons problems to us is awful. But before the problems of the monsoons, I have no other choice than electrifying. And in order to repower, I need to burn. What can I burn? Whatever I can, I will burn it. Obviously, without prejudice to the fact that the best example is China, who is going to build more renewable than the rest of the world together, and at the same time that they're launching a very ambitious nuclear program, and they're at the same time building steel gas plants, because they have an engagement, interestingly, from Glasgow, which is not financing coal plants outside of China. That's interesting, right? Outside of China, yes, but we in China do whatever we want. That, to me, is extremely important if we talk about energy. But what do we have now? The choke points issue, which is a problem per se. We don't know what's going to happen. In Omuth, there's going to be an imbalance. Considering the situation in Iran, we need to wait and see, being very expectational. We need to see what's going to happen. Let's hope there's not many disorders. And then Suez. Suez is the other thing that is going to have an effect on the region. Egypt is in a very complicated situation. The revenues of Suez are fundamental, and Egypt is a very important key for the stability of that region. So once again, Jose Juan mentioned energy is embedded in geopolitics. We have another thing there which has to do with energy also, which is the fact that the United States is leaving the region for many reasons. But the first reason why there's not such a big presence of the United States in that region is that they don't depend on them. They are the first exporters of LNG and the first exporters of oil also, with another incognita, which is what's going to happen after the elections. Is the attitude of Biden going to prevail, having cut the permitting of LNG terminals, as we're seeing now? Is instead Trump going to go in and say, drill, baby, drill? What's the effect of that? It's a complicated equation. And if we go back to the EU, I believe we have a new period with elections to the European Parliament. And we can only speculate there, but they're going to change. The ill feeling is going to change. I recently wrote a paper saying that the European Union was clearly behind the idea of the Green Deal, the fact that Europe was always the flagship of the movement of taking into consideration climate change. We've always promoted that, and Europe needed to continue being the flagship. But our regulatory power is very important. Brussels is a very important effect, yes. But let's say that in the new world, where unfortunately the international order, the WTO organization is being weakened, and we have a more complicated situation, the EU is going to continue along that pathway. I don't think it makes sense to change 180 degrees. But obviously, the European Union is going to take into consideration the protests of farmers, and something very important, the EU needs competitiveness. And companies seem to suffer from the rigors of the regulation, of the complexities of the regulations, of the difficulties of red tape. And obviously, we are living in a world where China subsidizes. These are state companies, and therefore they don't follow the same rules. And the United States has thought about subsidizing and subsidizing to be at the head of what they consider the technologies which are leading edge for energies that are going to determine the world. So I agree with you, Jose Juan Ruiz. The world is going to be determined by technologies, by green tech. I don't want to run out of time and not have the opportunity of talking about Spain. So I have a very specific question for you, Ana. What's the role you believe Spain plays in this landscape you've designed? What are the geopolitical advantages in Spain, comparatively? Well, in Spain, in energy, we've given a good example that I hope we did for everything else. We've had an estate policy. When one reads that there's energy policies which are renewables, which are left-wing, and others which are right-wing, I tell them, don't you dare think that the big problem of renewables was launched by the first government of Nemesio Fernández Cuesta, who is the PP, our big pope of this situation. So there's been a clear bet determined by geography, by the Pyrenees. We know our neighbors very well. Our neighbors didn't want an integral European market. Probably that's one of the reasons why we have not integrated these networks or grids of energy. So in Spain, we decided to promote LNG. And that has proven that even if we are criticized sometimes based on history of why different regions wanted to have LNG close to them, but what has been proven is that we were right in times of crisis. Spain has not had problems of supply, and that's really good. And you, Nato G, know a lot about that. But also, we've been key for France, who at the same time had difficulties of half of their nuclear fleet. They were able to have gas and electricity. We've exported a lot in connections which are very small, very few, but we've used them to the maximum, and that's proven that it was a very good thing. So we in Spain have reached a consensus. And we know that we have to reach an agreement about the nuclear power. In my past, amongst the many things that I've done, I have been a member of the executive committee and vice president for the world of Areva. That's why I have the reflex about having negotiated with China and India. It makes absolutely sense to maintain the nuclear plants as long as we can, in up and running. Going into a nuclear program, frankly speaking, does not make sense nowadays. But we all need to know that unless we say we want to maintain the nuclear plants very soon, or that's going to disappear, because you cannot turn on or turn off nuclear plants. It's not as a gas plant. So that's this landscape that we have to face. And then Spain and the Spanish presidency in the COP also have played a very important role. Do I agree with everything? Well, not really. I'm more realistic rather than dogmatic. But yes, it's important being dogmatic from time to time. I believe that now what Europe is doing is that Europe is thinking about how to be more realistic due to the circumstances. So yes, we, Spain, have played an important role in the European construction ever since we're part of Europe. For sure, in energy, we've been there for a long, long time, I insist. The history of the support for renewable energies, and it does make sense for Spain to continue supporting that. Spain is one of the first countries that supported a trunk network of hydrogen, which does not belong to Spain. 2030, that is a European project. But Spain's there, in the same way that Spain was in solar energy or leading many other initiatives. Well, we hope that that is combined with the fact that we know that gas is still necessary. The idea of the fact that we're not going to have gas in 5 years and we're not going to renew the contracts, well, Bujanek is doing something that we know is going to be necessary. That's going to be a transition which is going to be much longer. No matter how much storage we know about intermittent energies, no matter how much pumping we have in Spain, which is very important, by the way, but we still don't have it there. So let's not try to eliminate gas, no matter what. Oil does not only serve to make electricity or to be exported. Not oil is in our lives, like glasses and plastics everywhere. So the alternative, when I'm told, well, this modeling, Europe needs to degrow. Well, where do we start growing down? Where do we degrow or grow down? With healthcare typical of the 50s, that would be the equivalent of growing down, right? Or let's not turn on the lights. How do we grow down? I think Spain, as always, plays an important role, a clear role, especially in energy, and the positions of Spain is more realistic. It's good to be dogmatic, but we need to be very realistic. That was my paper, the paper I published recently. Thank you very much, Anna. We cannot grow down in terms of time. Well, we're tightening. We're time efficient. Yes, reasonably. We're doing well on time, more or less, reasonably. Thank you, Anna.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much, Anna. Thank you, Gonzalo. Those were very interesting reflections about an extremely complex situation that we're facing, right? There's many players, there's many balances. Everything is interconnected, everything is interdependent. We've been talking about infrastructures and materials. All of that has different political implications which are relevant. Anna mentioned something that I'd like to underline, the paper about the need to be realistic as a starting point to be able to find solutions which are more adequate for all. Now let's go to the next part of the seminar, where we're going to have a round table with panelists who are experts in energy, and especially in the area where we in Spain are concentrating. We're going to have this conversation, which Gonzalo Escribano is once again going to chair. This panel, we've agreed the presentations, or rather the introductions, to presentations to be brief so as not to take time from the debate, because obviously we could spend the entire morning considering the huge experience they all have.
Bear in mind, I would like to introduce first to Harry Tsimitras. Harry is director at Peace Research Institute, Oslo Cyprus Center, and senior fellow at Atlantic Council. He's an expert in energy security and geopolitics, the law of the sea, foreign policy, and the Eastern Mediterranean. Here with us is also Sobet Karbuts. He's a director of Hydrocarbons and Energy Security Division at the Mediterranean Observatory for Energy and Climate. He has worked also for the EIA and in several institutions and companies in different countries as Austria, Germany, and Turkey, of course. And finally, he is with us online is Lori Haitayan. Lori is Middle East and North Africa Director at the Natural Resource Governance Institute. Her activity focuses on the geopolitical dimensions of MENA's energy sector. Unfortunately, due to a last minute problem, he cannot be physically with us, but yes, thank you. Thank you, Lori, for your flexibility. We have been able to organize his presence online. Thank you so much for accepting all of you our invitation and for being here with us or connected as Lori. And I would like the last point to indicate to the audience that all of you can send your questions for those who are connected online through the platform, and for those who are here in the room through the cards that the organization has distributed. Thank you, of course, to all that are now attending the seminar also. Nothing more from my side. Gonzalo, please, the floor is yours.
Muchas gracias, Manuel. Como ven ustedes, hoy hago doblete, así que intentaré ser...
Thank you very much, Manuel. I'm going to be brief.
We'll start with Harry, if you agree. And by the way, thank you so much, Laurie, from Brussels, for making the effort to be with us. We really appreciate. Harry, I will ask you first, because you are more an expert on the geopolitical dimension, I will ask you to give us kind of overview on the geopolitics of the Eastern Mediterranean region. What's the current geopolitical framework in the region? Are, as usually my president used to say, are geopolitics trumping geoeconomics in the region? Or what's your view on that?
Thank you, Gonzalo. Thank you very much for the invitation and for hosting him here. And the usual disclaimer on very personal views, and I think you'll see why. When Andrei Gromyko, as foreign minister of the Soviet Union, was asked to describe relations with the West in one word, he said good. And in two words, not good. And unfortunately, that's pretty much the situation in this Mediterranean in two ways. One, I think we need to realize that what's happening in that region is both the outcome of what's happening globally, but reversely, what happens in that region also affects other regions and indeed the global situation. So we had a difficult discussion to start with in geopolitical terms, in economic terms, in terms of relations between the various states, but also within the states. And then things happened. So the first thing that I think needs to be understood is that as an outcome of now Gaza, but also before the war in Ukraine, the Nagorno-Karabakh, the first thing is really that there is no such thing as a frozen conflict. I don't think we should be taking anything for granted internationally, because unfortunately we have been doing this for some time. So the geopolitical situation is a direct outcome, as I say, both of conflict in the narrower sense, but also of trends that have been happening in the broader region. You have a set of traditional challenges, if you like, the well-known bilateral problems between Greece and Turkey, the Cyprus issue, the obviously the Israel-Palestinian crisis and all. And then on top of this, a new set of challenges were allowed to be built, exactly because we've allowed these disputes to draw so long in time, such as energy issues. On top of which, a new layer comes in the form of Syria, in the form of Libya, other conflicts, and on top of which you now have a new layer of a new hot conflict, as you like. So, as I say, we can't take things for granted, either positively or negatively. Nobody perhaps would have seen a year before it happened the very positive developments of the Abraham Accords, the way that Israel came very close to its Arab neighbors, the fact that Lebanon and Israel, two countries that not only don't recognize each other, but are technically in a state of war, managed to sit together, yes, with US mediation, but sat together as a matter of principle to delimit a maritime border. So when there is a will, there is a way. But also nobody would have foreseen the October the 7th events. And so in a sense, I take exactly the lead from what Anna was saying. Realism and pragmatism need to be at the forefront of our minds. I also think that we need to have a sense of urgency, because that seems to be slipping us. And I desperately also think that we need to extend our thinking, to think outside the box, if you like, simply because the box itself has not really led us very far.
Thank you so much, Harry, for being for this wonderful synthesis. And I will move now to Shobeth, who is a great expert on natural gas. That is, as you know, a very significant driver of geopolitics. We don't know if for cooperation or for conflict, or probably for both at the same time, in the region. And it's true that a lot has changed in the East Med geopolitics over the last 15 years. There are new alliances, there are new alignments. So my question would be, which role do you see for energy in general and gas in particular in the region? What do you think will be the points that you would like to highlight?
First of all, it's been a great pleasure and honor to be here for that. I thank you very much for the kind invitation. Well, you know, in 15 years, a lot has changed in terms of geopolitics and energy in East Mediterranean region. But when you look at the East Mediterranean region, you know, normally we talk about gas. So far, the amount of gas that has been discovered in the region is equivalent to the amount of gas discovered in Norway. So it is a huge region in terms of gas amount that is discovered. But when you take into account of the amount of gas that could potentially be discovered, then we would have North Sea, in fact. Whether it will be discovered or not, and if it is discovered, whether it will be put into production capacity, we don't know. But a lot will depend on the geopolitical developments. So what has happened? Harry mentioned a few of them. So for example, in 2008, you know, the relations of Turkey with Israel started to deteriorate. And also the relations between Turkey and Egypt deteriorated after the ousting of Morsi in 2013. But in the meantime, what we have in 2009, 10, 11, very large discoveries. Leviathan, Tamar, and Aphrodite fields. So more or less coinciding. And in the meantime, so the Turkish relation with Israel and Egypt worsened, and Cyprus and Greece played a very active role. So they had their trilateral meetings with Israel, with Egypt, and with Jordan, with Lebanon, and these trilateral meetings, etc. Gas was also in the center, led to establishment of East Med Gas Forum. And soon afterwards, as Ari mentioned, in August 2020, we have Abraham Accords. What happened is that in Abraham Accords, it was not only political things. Then we saw that the flowing investments of Arab investments even to Israel. You know, things have been moving. And then in 2021, January, the relations between Gulf Cooperation Council and Qatar has been, you know, normalized. And within these things, of course, Syria, Lebanon, and Turkey were excluded. So a kind of, as you mentioned, new alliances and new alignments have been shaped. But with the starting of normalization effort between Turkey and Egypt and Israel until October, were putting us into more optimistic way. But after that, things have changed again. So I will stop here. Maybe we continue later.
Thank you so much, Sobet. Yeah, that's a very complex and, you know, changing situation, and very volatile in geopolitical terms. I will now move to Lauri. And Lauri, I hope you can hear me properly.
Yes.
And I would like to go more to the case of Lebanon. That is very, very few people here in Spain are aware of the very, almost tragic energy and poly crisis, in fact, the country is suffering. And I think it's a good case study to start, you know, from going from the regional side to a more individual case for our audience to understand what's going on in your country, but also what could, how this can reverberate in the region. So my question would be, what would you like to explain to us of what's going on in Lebanon in terms of the energy crisis?
Yes, thank you. And first of all, I'm really sorry I couldn't be in person. But at least maybe I contributed to less carbon by not flying, but being here in Brussels and talking to you about our region. So at least this is like something that I contributed. So thank you all. As you said, maybe Lebanon, yes, is one of the Eastern Mediterranean countries. Very interesting. A couple of points that I will highlight that shows a bit maybe the possibilities and the complexities of the region. Within the region and vis-a-vis maybe Europe as well. So Lebanon in 2019 and in Bailey in 2020 had a full collapse of the country, multiple crises on the economic level, financial level, and currently we see even on a security level. So basically, when all these collapses happen, the weakest link first collapses. And the weakest link already was the power sector in Lebanon, which had suffered years of mismanagement and years of, if you want, let's put it as mismanagement and not go far from that. So basically what happened is like the Lebanese main utility, the Electricité du Liban, EDL, the public utility, was unable to provide electricity anymore to the people. And then even on top of that, the generators, the private generators that would complement usually the lack of electricity, were unable to provide as well because there was lack of money in the country to be able to import and buy the fuel needed. In that situation, one opportunity came up to connect Lebanon to the region, and that was through a project of giving Lebanon gas from Egypt, so transferring gas from Egypt to Lebanon through the Arab pipeline, that is an infrastructure that exists in the region, that would cross Egypt to Jordan, to Syria, and then to Lebanon to give electricity through the gas and power stations that run on gas. And the other collaboration or interconnectivity project was to for Jordan to provide Lebanon electricity through the grid, again crossing the grids from Syria to Lebanon. These were like two interesting interconnecting projects. However, they faced with political problems internally and externally. So basically, with the gas from Egypt to Lebanon, the main problem were the Caesar Act sanctions that were put on Syria by the U.S. government. Even though this idea of connecting the or flowing the Egyptian gas to Lebanon was a U.S. idea and supported by the U.S. government, but the U.S. Treasury had a problem, and they wanted to make sure that this project and this gas that will flow through the pipelines of Syria to Lebanon is not going to support the Assad regime, the Syrian regime. And therefore, the Lebanese had to guarantee that this is not going to support the Assad regime. And on top of that, the Egyptian government wanted guarantees that if the gas flows from Egypt to Lebanon, this is not going to affect Egypt, and that a change in administration in the U.S. will not have an impact on that. So if this is a Democratic-led initiative, if the Republicans come and take over, then maybe the Republicans will use that to punish or to sanction the Egyptian government. And therefore, that was one of the main issues why this project failed and didn't see light, because of the political dimension and the geopolitical dimension of it. On the Jordan and Lebanon failure of that project of linking electricity between Jordan and Syria, Lebanon, it was more beyond the Caesar Act, because for Jordan, they felt more secure that the U.S., whatever government there is, like Democrats or Republicans, Jordan is very important for the security of the region and for the security of Israel. Therefore, they don't mind much, like they wouldn't be sanctioned. So it wasn't a concern, but more it was an internal concern this time that Lebanon did not fulfill its commitments to the World Bank. And therefore, there was no money to link the projects on that. So this is kind of where you can see the opportunities, because mainly that gas project, gas to Lebanon from Egypt, or even the electricity from Jordan to Lebanon, had a component, a very interesting component, which was like, to some extent, that gas or that electricity, some part of it is Israeli gas that is flowing and is Israeli gas that goes into the Jordan market that produces electricity. So indirectly, again, Lebanon and Israel, who are at war, but there might have been this connection through energy. And this is like one of the, if you want, like the absurdity and the beauty and the complexity of the region. I stop here. I can go later on the gas and renewable competition that is happening as well in the region and in Lebanon, but I'll stop here and I'm ready to answer your other questions, Gonzalo.
Thank you so much, Lauri. We keep on with Larry now, and I will pose you a second question if you agree. We have been talking about many projects in the region. We got this EastMed pipeline, we got these electricity interconnectors, the Euro-Asia, Euro-Africa, with Cyprus connecting to either Egypt or Israel. As Lauri just said, I mean, the current geopolitical situation is much more complex. My question to you, I mean, there are many other projects. My question to you would be, is it possible for you to give us a realistic appraisal of what the situation is and how this can impact, energy needs, which opportunities we can foresee there? What are the main challenges and which planning do we need to start thinking on in order to address such this situation?
Sure. First of all, I think I can top up Laurie's absurdity, saying that now the situation in North Cyprus is such that Israeli interest companies are having construction sites selling to Iranians who live permanently there. So realism is there, and again maybe business trumps geopolitics. So what you were saying, I think, is right in two senses. One is that there are opportunities perhaps for the EastMed, I knew, after the crisis, especially in Ukraine, because the crisis in the Ukraine war meant both the need for alternative supplies, hence the EastMed again in the picture that was not before, simply because Europe could not have been a destination for gas. And secondly, it highlighted energy security over climate change concerns, at least in the short term, again placing the EastMed in the possible focal point. But at the end of the day, I think we have been very unrealistic and missed a lot of opportunities, especially because it was politics, if you like, political decisions, very rarely with sound grounding on the technical side and the economic side, that allowed for decisions to be made, or more importantly, not to be made, and opportunities missed. And then we ended up in a terrain where we had very problematic cases of exploration, exploitation, and even in the successful ones, we could not plan long term. What I mean to say, do you remember the hype over the Zohr field in Egypt? And the Zohr field has been massively underperforming to about a third of what was the projected initial capacity, posing added challenges for Egypt. On top of this, because of the, I don't want to say pharaonic, but at least the grandeur of the projects in Egypt, it means that the massive influx of cash, I understand that there is about 50 billion pumped in through a combined effort of the EBRD, the IAB, the Gulf, and all that, is probably going to be used in different ways rather than directly poured in to the energy infrastructure, making for a really, really tough case in Egypt. That has both economic repercussions and political repercussions. Obviously, Egypt in an extremely dire financial situation with a devaluation of the pound, with massive external debt. They simply have no dollars to spend as such, with exceeding energy needs that will have a political footprint. I remind you that El-Sisi was brought about to a large extent through power shortages and cuts. So cuts brought him, cuts have the capacity to take him away. So obviously the political card is played. But this political card is played very intensely also by the forces abroad. Israel is extremely keen on the maintenance of the regime in Egypt for its own political purposes. Europe the same, because obviously uncertainty is not in the DNA of the European Union and Europe in general, but also because simply the fact is that other issues are in play, like migration, and not only in the sense that Egypt is keeping at bay millions and millions of potential migrants to Europe, those 6 million of people around Lake Chad, others and all, but also because of potential Egyptians doing so. If I understand it correctly, Egypt, in order to keep things as they are, without improvement but with no deterioration, need to be creating 1 million new jobs per year for its youth, and I don't think this is very likely. So obviously these migrants are potentially migrants to Europe, and hence Europe has a great interest in keeping things at bay. That's the negative part. The positive part is that I think the amount of region of energy found in the region, A, can be used for local consumption and address the local needs of the whole region, and that I think would be fantastic. Secondly, the future of the region is most probably interconnectivity and electrification, hence the cables you talk about, if we don't screw up politically on them, as we have been wonderfully doing with gas until now through disagreements between the countries. And thirdly, by giving, I think, different messages to the ones we've been giving until now. I refer specifically to the European Union that has been giving, to my mind, mixed messages until now. You can't have the organs like the EBRD and EIB having stopped legally funding anything on fossil fuels, and at the same time, the European Commission funding with seed funding the East Med potential gas pipeline or gas pipe dream, whatever you name it. These are mixed messages that really do not help. We need to have a concise, coherent effort on the part of the EU, because fortunately or unfortunately, what comes out of the EU in that region is taken in a metaphysical quality. If it comes from the EU, then it's nearly given to us on plaques from abroad. And so there is added responsibility, I think, that we need to have.
Thank you, Harry. I turn now to show that in your previous intervention, you just stopped before the October the 7th events in Israel and the subsequent crisis and Israeli attacks on Gaza. My question now would be, could you please help us to understand what has been the impact of this Gaza crisis on the regional energy dynamics?
Let's focus a few countries first and then look at the regional implications. The biggest loser is Gaza, because we are back to square one in terms of the development of Gaza marine field. As you know, this Gaza marine field, 30, 40 billion cubic meters, not too much, baby. But was discovered 25 years ago. And there were several attempts to develop the field, etc. Israel never allowed. But last year, in June 2023, Israeli government officially announced that they are giving green light for the development of this gas field. And Egyptian state-owned gas company, IGAS, and a private company were supposed to start physically developing the field end of October. And the field was supposed to be produced, start producing early 2024. And just a few weeks before the physical work started, we know what happened. So the future of the field, God knows. No, again, we will wait maybe another 25 years. Egypt, Hari mentioned a lot. Economy is doing very bad. Currency devaluations. Problems everywhere in the neighborhood. $57 billion have been secured. Well, Hari was very political. $24 billion of which will be invested to create a tourism city in the Mediterranean. So investments need to be done wisely. Suez Canal revenues, also Anna mentioned, etc. But let's look at energy. Finally, after the discovery of Zohr and some other quite significant important fields, Egypt finally become an LNG exporter, even a net gas exporter. But today, the natural LNG exports 3 cargoes in January, 2 cargoes February, 1 cargo March, 0 cargo in April. Actually, in April, they already imported a cargo. And they now rented an FSRU, regasification floating ship, to import LNG between June and October. So they need to invest so that they can produce and satisfy demand. And the plans of getting more gas from Israel is not doing well, because now we move to Israel. Several projects have been delayed. That was the purpose to increase the production capacity in Leviathan and Tamar and increase the connections or increase the capacity of, in Israel, some pipelines and also increase the export capacity to Egypt. These have been delayed, but it doesn't mean that it will stop. Instead of 2024, they will be delayed in 1 year, maybe 1.5 years. But because of these issues, the floating LNG export project is put on hold for the moment. And one other thing for Israel was important, it was that a year ago in March 2023, United Arab Emirates company, ADNOC and BP, put a deal to take 50% of NewMed Energy, Israeli company. 2 days ago, there was an investment investor relations news from NewMed Energy. It says, ADNOC's 50% NewMed Energy take has been indefinitely suspended. So this is a fun thing. But the Mubadala, another UAE company, owns 10% stake in Tamar. There is no talk on that. So for Israel, the impact just for delaying of projects and maybe also in upstream projects. And pipeline capacity increases. When we look at the regional parts, just in a few words, is there were some efforts to increase electricity interconnections in the region. Those probably will be delayed. And one more thing that will be probably suspended is the agreement between UAE, Jordan, and Israel on water for electricity deal. And renewable energy, we talked, maybe this will be delayed too, because the investors would like to have a secure environment to operate. So who is the winner? Everyone is loser. Some are big losers, some are small losers. I don't know, but arguably could be a country who's having war now in Ukraine.
Okay, that's very clear. Regarding the Gaza crisis and Gaza being the main loser, we have to remember that Gaza itself has been suffering for an energy crisis for years now. I mean, even before the events, lights were out more than half of the day. And this has led to a huge increase in renewable energies, in fact, to solar panels. I mean, because many Gazans, they couldn't rely either on the horrible management of the Hamas government in terms of energy. It has been a mess. These are my words. But also, they couldn't rely on electricity being sent by Israel. So this population has developed a lot of solar panels, and there was this momentum thinking, oh, finally, renewables got a place in supporting peace, on giving more autonomy, strategic autonomy, as we call it in the European Union. But then October the 7th came, and all these solar panels that we, with our cooperation funds, have been helping to build in hospitals or houses or facilities, have been destroyed. So this led us to this naive approach that renewables will bring peace in somehow. It depends on the geopolitical setting very much. With that, trying to link this with this relation between renewables and introducing renewables and competition between renewables and gas in the region that has been already mentioned, I would like to ask to you, Lauri, if you agree on that, how do you see this coexistence, competition, complementarity between renewables and gas in the region? How this influence the subject of our meeting today? In how can geopolitics influence the transition pathways of the region?
Yes, definitely. And before I go to that, just like one again, like. A positive note for the region, so that it's not, you don't go after this like with like doomsday and everything is black. So I guess like to talk about energy and what's happening in the region, it's clear by now that there is a red line, which is like not to attack energy installments or any kind of gas platforms, etc., by all parties, being it like Israelis, Iranians, their proxies, and the U.S. So that is very clear, because whatever happens and any attacks on any kind of assets that have to do with the supply of energy could affect the global energy prices. And looking at what we're seeing, no one wants to see like a price of oil going up to $100 or more, because we think we're getting out of recession or economic slowdown. So we don't want that. So that's why we see that even when Israel is attacking Iran, is not going after the gas or oil. The same for the Red Sea attacks. They're not targeting directly the oil tankers, etc. They're doing something else. Even inside, like where Lebanon is involved in the war, they have not threatened the Karish platform. And Karish platform is an Israeli gas field that is very close to the Lebanese borders. And there might be under attack by Hezbollah, which has the capacities to attack them. But never that had been threatened during all the 6 months. The same, even when Tamar closed down early on, there were no direct attacks on Tamar, but it was a preventive action by the Israelis to close down the Tamar field. And they closed it for almost a month. And automatically, more than having an effect on Israel, it affected Egypt. And that's why they had to come back. And on that note as well, Egypt and Israel's flows of gas are still continuing, even when the tensions are at the highest. The gas never stopped flowing from Israel to Egypt, and the same from Israel to Jordan, even though they are at the peak, at the highest of this agreement when it comes to the activity, the military activities in Gaza. So therefore, that's very important to understand as well, the interconnectivity in the region when it exists, it does create stability. So this interconnectivity that exists today through energy between Israel, Jordan, and Egypt, it is still standing. Yes, definitely the other project, which was the renewable versus water project, which was linking that Jordan to Israel. So Jordan gives renewable electricity because it has the space to put the power, the renewable plants, the solar plants. In exchange, Israel gives what Jordan needs, which is water. And that all was sponsored by UAE money. Anyway, that project hadn't started yet. So we cannot say that it was stopped because of the war. Anyway, there were other problems with that. But saying that, these kind of interconnectivity definitely will bring stability and bring stability, even though the region looks crazy. So to go back to your question quickly about this competition between gas and renewables, definitely in the Eastern Mediterranean, the only two countries that have gas discoveries and exploitation and using it is Egypt and Israel. Israel has more capacities to be able to export within the region and even outside the region through the infrastructure that exists in Egypt, which is like through the LNG terminals. At the same time, Turkey has found, not in the Eastern Mediterranean, in the Black Sea, definitely discoveries that will help its own needs. But Lebanon, no gas discoveries. Same for Syria. And Cyprus has discoveries, but unable to develop it for different reasons that we don't want to go into it. But there was this very political hype by all political parties in all these Eastern Mediterranean countries about gas. And on that made them kind of like preferring to develop the gas field on finding alternatives to powering their the electricity needs that they have. But anyway, most of them, none in the region, has a target of 100% of use of renewable in the energy mix. I guess like because of technical reasons and definitely because they still want to focus on gas, because in the region, they feel that gas gives you political leverage and gives you income as well, revenues that they are in need for. So that's one aspect to it. The renewable energy, definitely today, we're seeing that there is a surge in renewables, and it is becoming more and more competitive because the money is there. The financing of renewables is something of interest to the Europeans or other agencies more than the gas. And this is where we are seeing that now countries are more interested in renewable projects to get that kind of investment coming in. That will help the economies as well. Because don't forget that many of the countries in the region are facing economic hardship. So it's not always out of necessity of conviction that we need to save the planet as it is in the EU, but it is more about different other reasons than saving the planet. And this is something I think that I would stop here, not go much, but like a message about the EU vis-a-vis Eastern Mediterranean or even North Africa. You cannot go with the Eurocentric vision of the energy transition. Many of our countries face hardships, and their interest in transitioning are for different reasons than saving the planet. And just like to be, make sure, and on that point again, like just to put it in the context, when we say that, it's like when you look at the region, so you see that you have on the northern North Africa, which is like closer to Spain, Algeria and Morocco, there's a cold war there. Tunisia and Egypt, they're struggling economically, and Libya is in chaos. So, and Algeria depends much on revenues from gas, and Morocco is trying to position itself as the leader when it comes to renewables and to hydrogen. So these are important incentives for Tunisia and for Egypt. The economic incentive of getting money into the country is more important than the renewable projects in themselves. And then you have on our side the Eastern Mediterranean, as I said, because Egypt, sometimes we put it in the Western Mediterranean, and sometimes we put it with us, depending on what we're trying to achieve. So again, as I said, there is a big struggle in economy, but at the same time, there's a big struggle in the internal energy consumption, and they need all sort of energy to be able to get to their people's consumption. Israel and Palestine today, even though it's tragic, but there is an opportunity. Gonzalo, when you say that everything has been destroyed, everything could be built the right way as well. And this is how we see it. As I said, Lebanon has a total collapse, and people are putting renewables as personal initiatives. We don't have large-scale projects because we cannot attract the money because of the failure of the banking system and the financial system, and there is no guarantee through the IMF. Syria is at war, and the Cyprus problem is where I will stop there, because for me, and I'm not an expert of Cyprus, but I really see potential for Cyprus. Cyprus could become the land of energy, the island of energy, and the island of peace, and it could play an important role in shaping the future of our region. Very quick, I keep on saying very quick, I'm sorry for that, but we, through like other colleagues of mine, we developed this idea of gas and renewables can coexist in the island, through the Greek part and the Turkish part, to provide electricity to Turkey, to Greece, to the region, us, and to Europe. So once you're in Greece, you're in Europe, and Cyprus is Europe. So that's an important to transform the island, instead of being a separated island, into an energy island. On top of that, peace island, because this is where Israelis and Palestinians and Turkish and Greek and others could meet in buffer zones to discuss about the future of the region. So Cyprus is very crucial. We have to think about it that way, and I stop there.
Thank you so much, Lauri, for giving us some reasons for a more constructive approach. I totally agree with you that we have to save some pessimists for better times. So now, perhaps what could be interesting, Harry, is, I mean, we have been talking of several issues, you know. You mentioned migration, there is security, there is climate that has played a significant role. I mean, last summer, the horrible heat wave that, you know, affected all the region has a significant impact on the blackouts in Egypt, on the chaos in Gaza, on the Lebanon crisis, and so on and so forth. So it will be really helpful for us if you can help in connecting the dots of all these different dimensions that are being mentioned in the region.
Sure, glad. Let me first build on exactly what Lauri was saying. The positive is that renewables for this region in particular, and for any region in trouble and conflict, are perhaps the way out, in the sense that renewables are not commodities like gas that countries feel obliged to fight over. The value added lies in the usage in common, if and when the states wish. By way of example, there is an electrical interconnection between Greece and Turkey. Very few people know about it, even few talk about it, but it's there, and it operates irrespective of the problems in principle. So again, pragmatism trumps things. But let's do this, connect the dots. I think we're missing very direly on this in providing threading, if you like. We desperately need to connect the dots in two ways. One, geographical. Second, thematic. In a sense, geographical, because what happens in the West Med, just to take one example, affects very directly, but also indirectly, the East Med and vice versa. What's happening in Egypt now, for instance, but beyond, the Houthis. Who thought in the past that they would have to get security clearance from the Houthis? We never knew who the Houthis were to get anything through the Red Sea to Egypt. Insurance prices have hit the ceiling. So obviously it very much affects the situation. It's an important discussion that we're having here in Spain on Morocco and Algeria and other places, but I don't think we can leave out the East Med, and we desperately need to connect geographical threading. The second thread that needs to be connected by way of dots is the thematic one. What happens in climate affects migration, which affects energy, which affects security. And so although we have very, very good discussions in each of these subjects very often, I don't really see usually a connection between them. Look at what's happening just climatically in the region, which, by the way, according to the UN, is one of the top regions of climate energy, of climate climate challenge-wise on the planet. The climate is basically a threat multiplier through the droughts that you explained, the food security issues, the evaporation increase, temperature and all that. This will lead to certain areas being uninhabitable. It will lead to domestic migration. In Egypt already, this is a great problem. To cities that the municipal infrastructure simply cannot take it, which desperately will need then to have external migration. And that migration is directly connected to energy needs. And so I don't think we always connect the dots, and I would suggest that we do so. Secondly, combined with this, we need to go 30,000 feet up and have a helicopter view of not only the region, but also perhaps more globally. What we discussed today stands for today. If the Trump administration comes in the United States in November, the projection is that the footprint of the US is going to be to add 4 billion tons of emissions until 2030. That is equivalent to the annual emissions of all of the EU and Japan together, or the equivalent of 140 of the lowest countries emission-wise on the planet annually. It will add at least $1 trillion of climate damage. And of course, it would mean that the US is missing its targets. Instead of 52%, it will be up to 28%. So we need to think globally, because that will affect us in this region very directly. The risk, both the physical risk, the security risk of transportation, of production, is heightened in this region. Companies are more averse to risk, obviously banks and the funding and all this. So I think we're going to be presented with a series of physical challenges, security challenges, financial challenges. The transition is wonderful, but transition will cost a few trillion. And I don't know where this money will come from in an era of extreme financial hardship otherwise. And a final point, if I may, just to build on what Sohbet was saying. It's not that the war in Ukraine led Europe to seek alternative supplies. It also meant that Russia has secured alternative markets, because it's not as if Russian energy just disappeared. It just moved from over the table to under the table, to unregulated. So 28 new contracts with African countries. So obviously it's there. Obviously we're going to find it ahead of us. And I'm very much for pragmatism. I'm not going to mention a country that just received an LNG shipment from Russia. But this is important. Yes, I understand. But I'm not saying give it up, but need to do it in a regulated way that will eventually combine the overall vision, if you like, with the way of attaining the target, hopefully today.
Excellent, Harry. Yeah, it's true that seems that Russia has been much more successful in diversifying us than the European Union has been in diversifying from Russia. Let's now, Sovet, if you agree, to look a bit to the future. What are the prospects? How do you see, what can happen in the coming years? And if you can, make us, what will be the spectrum between the optimistic scenarios and the more pessimistic one? Which are the options that we are facing in the region regarding energy geopolitics?
Yeah. You may agree or not, but in my view, energy is the only denominator that brings all the countries in the region together. They all need it. But energy, I put in general. Well, arguably, electricity, for example, is the most important form of energy. If there is no electricity now, the life would stop. No, we could not hold this. Lori would be sitting on her desk, and nobody is more or less carrying cash. No, you cannot take cash. Life would stop. So we need electricity, but you produce it from fossil fuels or not. This is another thing. The region has both, as I said. In terms of undiscovered and discovered resource potential, there is huge potential gas, but there is huge potential of solar and wind, that you can produce electricity instead of having blackouts today. So energy is important, but natural gas so far have shaped even the politics. But definition of natural gas is changing too. Today, in Europe, for example, we don't talk about natural gas anymore. We say gas is fuels. What is gas is fuels? Natural gas, biomethane, and hydrogen, which is at the end is gas anyway, hydrogen gas. So when we look at the region again, okay, natural gas is fossil gas is there. But biomethane, biogas is not discussed at all. Why? Because there is no technology, there is no investment, etc. So how to develop so that, energy is an indicator of development. When you look at the electricity consumption per capita, GDP per capita, it is nearly parallel. Energy consumption or GDP goes parallel. You have to consume energy. So the region has the energy, but we need enablers. What are the enablers? Well, having an attractive investment climate. So physical security and also political and geopolitical security. Then the people or the companies would come and invest. And maybe not only for East Med, but the Mediterranean in general, which we at OMEC propose, we need a Mediterranean Green Deal. So it is not copying the European Green Deal, but with its own originalities. We need a Mediterranean Green Deal. But how do you do all these things? This is a problematic region, East Mediterranean. So these alignments, alliances don't work. We need to be pragmatic. We need to create a joint projects, joint development mechanism, for example, joint exploration projects because of the Cyprus issue, et cetera, because maritime borders in the region is not determined. Joint infrastructure projects, even creating a virtual hub. Why not, as Larry said, Cyprus could be a bridge. Why not in Cyprus? But how do you do all this complicated thing? Is that we need a mechanism. What is the mechanism? We have a mechanism, for example, East Med Gas Forum, an intergovernmental organization or international organization. It doesn't work. I mean, for the press, it doesn't work. You can delete it because I'm representing OMED in East Med Gas Forum, Gas Industry Advisory Committee. East Med Gas Forum, but in fact, maybe it should be renamed. East Med Energy and Climate Forum, something like this, because we are not talking about gas anymore. We have to go beyond. But as mentioned before, Turkey, Northern Cyprus, Lebanon, Syria is not there. So you cannot do anything in East Mediterranean as an international body. No. We need a non-governmental forum. I don't know, just come to my mind. For example, you guys, bringing academics, even government officials, industry together from all countries. So far, there is no place that could bring all these actors and discuss these issues. So there is no other way than cooperation and collaboration, but even for that, we need a place.
And that place is... We can cooperate with OMEC on that.
Why not?
Okay, thank you so much. I move now to Laurie, and I'm going to start with, I have already received some questions, so I'm going to start to introduce some of the questions. Laurie, if you agree. This question I think is very fit for you because, you work in a resource-oriented governance institute. There are some questions on how can we improve energy governance in the region? There is another question on to what extent fossil subsidies in the region are preventing deployment of renewables. And another one is you mentioned before, they said, yes, you have mentioned mismanagement of resources. Where are we at that point and what can we do? By the way, there are other questions that I already advanced to you on the role of the European Union that you just alluded to it, on the future of Israel-Iran tensions, and others. So I start to introduce them in order for you, if you want to address any of them. So, Lauri, whenever you want.
Thank you. So you gave me the hardest questions, which are like more about like internal dynamics, country dynamics. So definitely there is no one governance for the region, as we of course understand, it's country by country. But what to say on the subsidy and governance issue, very important. It's like the at least I can speak on behalf of not on behalf, but I can. What I will say maybe applies to the Arab Mediterranean countries. A social contract has been built on the government providing services, subsidized services, to the people. And one of these services is the energy and electricity. So what you see today, when you are saying that me as a country, I am able to give you almost cheapest electricity possible because I'm subsidizing it for different reasons. I can afford or I cannot afford, but this is the social contract. Today, under the energy transition, we need to move into another sort of generation, which is through the renewables that might cost you more. So now the governments have to tell their people that we are changing the social contract. We are going to make you pay more. And then the people will be like, okay, so then what do I get in return? And that's the core and the beauty of the complexities of the region about the social contract and how to redefine social contract between the citizens and the and the political elite in the countries, from Morocco to Algeria, to Tunisia, to Libya, to Egypt, to Israel, to Palestine, to Lebanon, to Cyprus, to Syria. All of that, it's like mainly, most of them, they have to redefine the social contract on this. So the energy transition is opening up discussions that I'm not sure that a lot of countries are interested in opening up because of different situations, security, and not being able to do it because they don't have the capacities, all of that. But these are issues that need to be understood from the European Union, needs to be understood from the US, so that Global North needs to understand like the complexities that come into the energy transition. It's not about switching from gas or heavy fuel oil or coal to renewables. It's deeper than that. Definitely, subsidies are one main barrier because, as I said, then you how to make it competitive. The second issue is about the private sector. Again, private sector competitiveness is important. It is important for the governments to allow private sector to thrive and to be able to work on that power generation. If we only want to talk about now electricity as energy transition, about an electricity sector and not the other, or power sector and not the others, because of course we all understand energy transition is beyond just like the power sector, but if we want to. But and then that's important because, again, structurally, these issues were built around the government utilities and the public utilities and the public investment. Now there is a need for the private investment. And here comes the complexities about the private competing with the public. And that is not easy as well. What is the main problem in Egypt today? It's because the military has control over the economy, which doesn't allow for the private sector to thrive. And this is where we're seeing the problems of lack of dollars or shortage of dollars or shortage of direct investments that are that country needs to grow the economy. So I stop here. I'm sure I didn't answer everything, but like at least this is like a flavor of what's happening in the region.
Thanks a lot, Laurie. We still have 8 minutes and I will select two questions. The first one is which role for the EU, what the EU should do. And the second is about where are we in energy reform, and what are the needs for energy reform in the region. So if you can have 3 minutes each, that would be great. And then we go for the conclusions. Who wants to start? You want to start?
Please.
Go for it.
Thanks. First of all, I'm going to challenge Sohbet. You don't need electricity to transfer money. Russian money in Cyprus went from south to the north in bags because of the sanctions. So that's fine. Secondly, I very much agree on rethinking the arrangements like the East Med Gas Forum to East Med Energy Forum. I think that's extremely important because, look, I've said this before, but cooperation is like cholesterol. You can have good cooperation and bad cooperation. If cooperation is designed or ends up in being exclusionary, then it's going to be short-lived. And I think the East Med Gas Forum started on a bad foot. That leads into the discussion on the EU. Part of the problem is that the EU, but not only the EU, to be fair, others, have been looking at the region in a fragmented way. And I would suggest that we need, as I said, go a little bit up, look at the whole region, have holistic solutions that bring in financial aspects to geopolitical aspects, various aligning member states, individual member states' interest to the EU, because unfortunately we can't really speak with an EU or Brussels voice if member states, depending on the case, have different agendas to be diplomatic about it. But the EU institutionally, to be a little harsher on the EU, the EU both needs to have a less myopic and more coherent view on this. But let's start with cooperating within the EU institutions. Just to take one example, you have a fantastic discussion at DG NEA until you reach the crux, and they say, ah, yes, but you need to take this up with DG Energy. And as long as you do that, ah, yes, but you need to have the discussion with external action. So I think we need to have also coherency on the part of the EU and have a realistic take, as I say. We also need to have, I think, a very honest discussion with Turkey, because like it or not, from realistic point of view, Turkey is there. Turkey will probably remain there. So we need to have an honest discussion rather than pretending we do. And then I think the last thing would be to have, if you like, a global view, in the sense that, look, we have a Eurocentric view and sometimes we have an EU-centric view, but Europe accounts for 8% of global energy consumption. The problem is elsewhere. Otherwise, we're going to end up with a very clean EU, in the sense of a luxury cabin in a sinking boat. We need to have global solutions. If India and China, together they're about 3 billion, half of the world, if they want to advance their living standards as they have declared by 30%, I don't want to know what the energy consumption needs will be. So let's again try to be a little bit less Eurocentric, putting our house in order first, but trying to be pragmatic in the sense that both the problems and the solutions, I think, need to be global.
So, but anything you want to do in 2 minutes would be possible?
I fully agree, but I would expand it not to Eurocentric, but Western-centric. You know, the all East Mediterranean, North Africa is global south. When we look at this, all these energy and climate issues, they are kind of dictated by global north, which has 1 billion population. And the rest, 7 billion population, this global north, is trying to dictate the policies, what the other 7 billion people should do. And it goes even beyond, now because of methane emissions, etc., like World Economic Forum says, eat bugs. You know, how the message is communicated is very, very important. You cannot exclude 7 billion people, some of which are sitting on, for example, in Africa, in many places in Africa, some of which are sitting on natural gas and oil reserves, and you do not give any financing for developing these reserves because of climate consideration. But in the EU, you can build 3-4 FSRUs in Germany, for example, immediately, and all the NGOs are not heard at all. But the same NGOs were applauding and celebrating when this mid-cut project between Spain and France was stopped. No, we should be really pragmatic, realistic, and listen what this global South think. Because those people, okay, they need to use their energy resources, fossil fuel or not. It is better to develop together with fossil fuel all the existing renewable resources, but we need pragmatism. So the North is not much cleverer than the South.
Lauri, you got the last 2 minutes.
Oh my God, okay. So what in 2 minutes, what I could say is, like, I do believe in interconnectivity and in collaboration and cooperation. Interconnectivity within the region, from North Africa to the Levant to the GCC countries, and with Europe. Europe is our neighborhood, and yes, maybe they live in La La Land, but I think, like, a lot of our countries would like to be in La La Land as well. So there is a lot of connectivity and a lot of work to be done. It's important, as my colleagues had said, to hear what we have to say and to hear for the EU as well concern. It's like two-way concern, but like, and to work and collaborate together on energy projects. So that's what I can say in less than 2 minutes, I guess.
Well, thank you so much to the three of you. It was very, very interesting. I will keep talking for many more time, but that will be the next time. And well, going from La La Land to Naturgy Land, this is now the time. I will hope that you will join me in saying thank you and clapping a lot for our speakers. Thank you so much to you all.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, you all. Really interesting debate with different approaches to the problem, which, as you said, is really, really with a high level of complexity. Based on your comments, I only would like to say that that perhaps let's hope that the energy sectors could help to solve or to ease the problems in the area, of course, taking into account that the political issues are there playing the main role. But perhaps all this cooperation or these commitments that you mentioned perhaps could help. Muchas gracias a todos por...
Thank you very much to you all for having attended. I think that the goals set forth by Naturgy Foundation and Real Instituto Elcano to open this debate and explain what is happening in other parts of the world, which are having also an impact on us, has been fulfilled thanks to the great knowledge of the experts that we have had here. I hope you had enjoyed it, and we'll see you again next time. Bye-bye.